WBNE.
Hello, and welcome to episode 68, all about Fellowship of the Ring, theatrical edition, part 2, being the 68th part of That's What I'm Tolkien About. My name is Mary Clay. If that's too complicated for you, just call me MC. And today I'm joined by Catherine Gonzales, founder and editor-in-chief of Shuffle Online. Welcome, Catherine.
Thanks for having me. I'm so excited to talk about this movie. It's funny because I was actually thinking about when I responded to you and also in preparing for the podcast, I was thinking about how this is a movie that I don't normally talk too much about in terms of like a public space, just because it's so sacred to me. And even though like I have my site and everything and I'm on social media a lot, I like will never touch Lord of the Rings unless it comes up naturally like it did with, you know, your tweet. I don't know. It's just something that holds a really special place in my heart. And this is like one of the first times I'm talking about it in this depth.
I'm honored then that you would come on and break that, you know, like, but because I get wanting to keep things that you hold near and dear in a protective bubble. It's hard when especially things that might not hold up under the test of time, but still hold us that special place in your heart. You don't want anyone to come for it. So I totally get that. Why don't you tell me a little bit about your background with Lord of the Rings? And also like specifically, if you remember the first time you watched these movies.
Seventh grade, my reading teacher, which seventh grade for me is back in, I think, 2002. And so we were reading The Hobbit, and I didn't know anything about Tolkien before that. And then I loved it. And we watched the cartoon movie of that. And then I just like went into a rabbit hole, and I wanted to know more about, you know, everything that he had written. And I stumbled into Lord of the Rings. And then I think I had got the book, and then the movie had already come out, like Fellowship. So then I watched that. And then it was nice because like the next one was going to be coming out, and like I got to experience the next two in real time. It all started with The Hobbit originally, and then went into Fellowship, and then I just got obsessed like a crazy amount. Like I had all the posters, I had everything. I would go into all, you know, the special like DVDs of the movie and like features, and yeah, it was just it all started back then. So
that's awesome. I also appreciate that you watched the cartoon Hobbit because I've heard it's something that like has this very like weird infamous legacy for Lord of the Rings, and I'm like really I've seen like screenshots and random snippets of it, but today we are not here to talk about the cartoon Hobbit, my friends, my listeners, that will come another time. We are here to talk about the middle hour or so of Fellowship of the Ring. Again, this is the theatrical edition. Future Mary Clay is going to jump in now with a summary of all of this, which is probably going to be really long. What up? It's Mary Clay from the future here to give you this week's movie summary. So I kind of lied to you last week when I said that this week we would be covering through 2 hours and 11 minutes, I think it was, because I went back and I readjusted some things because a lot happens, as you will hear from this summary. We pick back up with Saruman's dirty fingernails looking into the Palantir as he talks with Sauron, who asks him to build an army of orcs. They immediately set to work, tearing down trees everywhere, which I'm sure won't awaken an ancient magic or entity of some kind. Gandalf is being kept prisoner in Isengard, and TBH, things aren't looking great for him right now. Aragorn brings the Hobbs to Amon Sul, where they immediately screw it up. The Nazgul find them, and Frodo puts the ring on to escape them, but for whatever reason continues to sit there and get stabbed. Lucky for him, Aragorn bursts in like a bamf and wards them off. Unlucky for Frodo, he's dying real fast. Back at Isengard, Gandalf can now talk to animals and sends a moth off with an important message, and Saruman is busy bringing orcs at a breakneck speed. It's disgusting, but bravo to the makeup department. It's not looking so great for Frodo. Enter Arwen, the representation of the male gaze, I mean an elf, who is also apparently Aragorn's girlfriend. She takes Frodo to escape the Nazgul, and they make it safely to Rivendell, where Arwen will continue to exist only for the purpose of men. Gandalf is there when Frodo wakes up, now mostly healed, and Frodo is all, where the f*** were you, man? We had to do some serious improvisation and it did not go well. In one of the best moments from Gandalf, he holds back about 5 pages worth of what happened and tells Frodo he was delayed. What an understatement. We see that he escaped Isengard on an eagle that for vague reasons can't take them to Mordor. In Rivendell, Frodo is reunited with Merry Pippin and Sam, and also Bilbo. As Sam and Frodo talk about their job being done, Elrond and Gandalf talk about how it's not done at all. With Isengard and Sauron watching the elves, the ring can't stay in Rivendell. Elrond gives more exposition, because it's been a while since we had some of that, and
explains how he saw the weakness of men when Isildur failed to destroy the ring. I get it, Elrond. Men are weak. Speaking of weak men, more people arrive in Rivendell, like Boromir of Gondor, as well as Legolas the Elf and Gimli the Dwarf. Boromir has a weird stare down with Aragorn while he stabs himself with Narsil, the broken blade that cut off Sauron's finger all those years ago. Aragorn seems to have some intense feelings about this sword, but I'm sure that won't come into play just as he needs to awaken an army of the dead. Just when you're ready for things to move forward with the plot, Arwen comes in to talk about Aragorn's commitment issues with her and his destiny as king. In a move no woman would ever make, she offers to give up her immortality to be with Aragorn. I mean, her body, her choice, but that's certainly not the choice I would go with. Finally, the Council of Elrond commences in a surprisingly brief and straightforward scene that covers 30 plus pages worth of character introductions and what's this? More exposition. I'll summarize what we learn here. Boromir's an idiot. Legolas is a homie. Gimli's ready to throw hands. The ring must be destroyed in Mordor. God bless the hobbits. And my axe. They all step in to join this mission quest thing, and together they are the Fellowship of the Ring. They set off on this mission quest thing and have lots of cute bonding moments along the way, including Merry and Pippin learning how to fight, hiding from birds that spy on them for Saruman, Boromir being tempted by the ring, a blizzard, Legolas just doing elf things, solving a riddle to get into Moria, and escaping from the Kraken. The Fellowship is left with no other choice than to go into Moria, which Gimli is stoked for until the terrible discovery that basically everyone he knows is dead. Gandalf guides them for a bit, forgets where they are for a bit, has a super powerful conversation with Frodo that isn't relevant at all today, and casually mentions that Gollum has been following them. Oh my god, this is a bad idea doing these summaries each week, but I started doing it and here we are. All right, back to the pod.
All right, cool. So we pick up with Saruman and Gandalf, that plot line. Saruman is looking into the Palantir and it's like very creepy looking, very on brand for like this section of the story. It's funny to me because the Palantir is way bigger than I thought it would be. I guess I was imagining the like prophecy orbs from Harry Potter.
Oh yeah.
That are more like the palm of your hand. The Palantir / Sauron tells Saruman.
Those are tongue twisters. Yeah, I remember.
I know. Yeah. It's going to get you. It's gotten me several times already through the books. And it's harder this time around because Saruman is in a lot more of the movies than he was in the books.
Okay.
He doesn't like show up at all in the books until Two Towers. And then you only hear Gandalf talking at the Council of Elrond. What happened, like past tense of like, yeah, I went to talk to Saruman. Turns out he's evil and he held me prisoner. Yeah, Sauron tells him to build up an army of orcs and they start chopping down those trees. And one of the orcs even makes a comment that, this might be foreshadowing. I don't know. About how the trees are very strong and the roots go deep.
Yeah.
Interesting. I guess we'll have to wait to see what comes of that. And then Gandalf is trapped on the top of Isengard in the pouring rain, and it's not looking great for him right now, to say the least. So,
yeah, no.
But we jump back to our more favorite part of the story, I'm assuming for most people. We're back with Aragorn and the hobbits. They arrive at Aman Sul, and those hobbits, they immediately get themselves into a pickle like they always do because Aragorn's like, okay, we're going to hang out here for the night. I'm going to go off and I don't know what Aragorn does when he leaves because he's gone for a while because he leaves when it's daytime and then it's long enough for Frodo to take a nap and the hobbits to cook a meal and then he doesn't. It's not like he was right around the corner because when he shows up for the Nazgul, it's a little bit too late at that point.
Yeah.
So I have no clue what he's doing at this point. I guess just random ranger things.
Yeah, I haven't really thought about that in a while. I wonder if he's also maybe looking for Eowyn maybe, or like, I don't know, like...
Oh, you mean Arwen?
Arwen, sorry, yeah. Because then she comes in obviously later, so I wonder if like...
They're having a little rendezvous or something.
Yeah, or scoping it out, you know, like... smelling stuff. I don't know.
Yeah. So Frodo wakes up. This is like a really comedically shot scene and I really appreciate it because Frodo is asleep and he like wakes up and he like turns around as the camera pans around and you hear, if you have the subtitles on too, you hear Mary, Pippin, and Sam. They're like, oh, you burnt the tomatoes. And they're like, do you want some toast? And they turn around. He turns around and they're all gathered around a fire cooking food. And they're like, hey, Frodo, you want some? And he's like, you idiots.
Yeah.
This isn't allowed. And he goes over and stamps out the fire.
It's funny because I think I think personally, I don't know if I'm biased, but they hold up so well, the movies. But there are some of those shots that I think are, it's just kind of like the era. Like they were probably really, really cool in 2001. But then now we've probably seen it so many times, or it's just like the effect is kind of it, now it seems like a little bit basic, but like seeing it in 2001 must be like, oh my God, you know, like it's just such good directing by Peter Jackson. But yeah, it's funny to kind of see some of those things that don't necessarily hold up as well in 2020.
Yeah, I think we're gonna bring up that point a lot more throughout this episode, especially at least for me, I think especially when we get to Moria. So it's too late though. The Nazgul, I think it pans away and you can see the plume of smoke up in the air, and the Nazgul are like, there they are. And so the hobbits run up to the top of Weathertop, and the Nazgul, I love the hobbits though. They do this like in a lot of moments where all three of them crowd around Frodo to protect him. And it's so sweet, and it's such an endearing quality for the hobbits, and like their loyalty and friendship that, like, because especially in this point in the story, they don't know how to fight. They like Aragorn literally just gave them swords. They don't know how to use them. And so even still jump in front to protect their friend, it immediately fails. The Nazgul come in and just like yeet Merry and Pippin and Sam out of the way. And Frodo puts the ring on to try and get away. And this is when it's not the first instance.
Yeah, he did it in the tavern.
Yeah, it's in the tavern when you see this effect where he's like half in this world, half not. And he sees like the evil side of the world, kind of, and the creatures and the people that have been touched by this darkness that he, you know, is wearing on as a ring. And when he puts it on this time, though, he can see the Nazgul as they were when they were old crusty white men. Which is terrifying. What's funny, though, is that, like, he puts the ring on and he just sits there.
Yeah.
He doesn't run away. I guess you could say, like, oh, he's, like, just in shock and he's looking around. But, like, he gets stabbed immediately because he hasn't moved at all. And the Nazgul can see where he is.
Yeah. And I wonder, like, yeah, what was the point of putting it on? But I think maybe in his eyes, he was, like, thought it would hide him, not knowing. And then, like, the shock of actually seeing them in a different form could also be, because if that happened to me, I'd be like, I'm like, I probably wouldn't have moved either.
Yeah.
And he's
yeah.
just like this little thing. So I think in that sense, it makes sense, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I do a lot of talk and like making fun of everyone in this situation, when in reality, I would probably die immediately. Like, I would probably be the Boromir of the situation. So
but I wouldn't die heroically like that either.
Yeah. Oh, I don't even think it would be heroic. I think it would be before then. I don't know.
Yeah.
I would like be in Moria and accidentally slip off and like fall.
Yeah, I would have totally fallen off the cliff.
Yeah. Yeah, so Frodo gets stabbed, ouch, and then comes in to save the day, Aragorn.
Yay.
And this was apparently Viggo Mortensen's first day on set, was this scene, this fight sequence, and it was his first time handling a sword. I think he did pretty good. The like actual cinematography of the fight isn't super great. It's all over the place, I think, to try and make it feel like, wow, a lot of action is happening here. Like, if you put that aside, it's very, he comes in here and gets and wards off 9 Nazgul. He sets one of them on fire. I don't know what your opinions were on that one, who got set on fire and like stumbles off the side. I thought it was kind of, I don't even think the word cheesy encompasses like what I felt about that, but yeah. Like,
it's so interesting hearing you talk about this and knowing that it's like been like a recent watch for you. Cause like, I mean, not that I'm like sugarcoating all, like it's, well, I do think it's the most amazing thing ever, but I'm not going to deny like, oh, of course, like when there's stuff that doesn't hold up or whatever, but it's so funny cause it really is something where I'm like, oh, but I remember watching that thinking like I used to watch when I was watching The Fellowship, like I would watch it by myself in my room and stuff. And I would get so scared, you know, and like, because, you know, to me, it was believable. And it was just like something I had never seen before. And like the effects were amazing and all that. And so even though I've seen so many more movies than this since then, but I still think it's like, to me, all of it makes sense. So when you're like, oh, what did you think of the fire? And I was like, yeah, like, that's what it is, you know? like it was badass. Like he put he came in and like killed the Nazgul, or you know, like, yeah, looking at it. And then I get what you're saying about the light, because I think this is probably reminiscent of like the 2000s, where it's more, you can see that it is a production, like, you know, a set and everything. It doesn't feel so as cohesive, I think, as like maybe modern, like nowadays, like movies feel a little bit more, some of them, if they're done right. And now I can really tell, like, oh, that is a set piece. But when I saw it back then, it didn't feel that way.
Oh, yeah. I totally understand what you mean with that. In the first episode for this movie, I like talked in a loop, basically, with my guest about, like, I don't really know if I like love these movies or if they're good movies for me, because like, I think they're great. I think they're like really good adaptations. And for the time, I think like it could have been way worse special effects and, you know, makeup or filming and editing than it is. And it's, there are a lot of moments where it's really good, but it's those moments that take me, I guess that's it, is that like the moment where he sets the Nazgul on fire and he just kind of like flaps his arms around and like waddles and like stumbles off Weathertop kind of took me out of the moment, because to me I was like, well, that was obviously like a stunt man they dressed up in Nazgul robes and put on a flame retardant thing and set him on fire as like a practical effects kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. It was something that like really took me out of the moment. However, a lot of the, for these movies in general, there's like a good balance of, for every like one thing that takes me out of it, there's like three more things that like really help me stay grounded in the world. Mm-hmm. Whether it's like the costuming or the acting or the story that's happening or the beautiful sweeping scenery, you know, yeah, things like that. Anyway, okay, so this story. Oh, one thing is, there's this line that Vig, I don't know why, if it really was his first day of filming, maybe he hadn't quite gotten into that like Aragorn accent, because it's also not really a British accent, mm-hmm, but it's also not a like American accent or anything. It's like half and half. And he says the line, he was stabbed by a Morgul blade, but he says it like he was stabbed by a Morgul blade.
Yeah.
He's been stabbed by a Morgul blade.
Listeners should know, I have rewatched Fellowship of the Ring many times in the last couple days. And every time that line, I just like cringe. And I'm like, could Peter Jackson not have been like, hey, Viggo, let's maybe do that again, just one more time. And he carries Frodo off like a baby.
Oh, yeah.
I love any time that happens with the hobbits. So we cut back to Isengard. Gandalf apparently in the movies can talk to animals, and he sends a message with a moth to presumably the eagles. And fun fact, I don't know why this is a trivia fact, but that moth was basically its only life was this one filming day, because this trivia says that the moth was born shortly before filming that scene and it died shortly after. So
that's
rest in peace, little buddy. You served a good life.
Thanks for your service.
Yeah, not many moths can say that they were a star in Lord of the Rings. So you did it. You did it, bud. This is one of the moments from the books, especially, or a theme from the book that kind of really comes through in this scene with Isengard and Saruman. Tolkien has this like huge commentary on the books about like nature versus industrialization. It was like a very relevant topic for him at the time, especially given that like he put a lot of his experiences from World War One into the books. You know, at that time in 1910s, 1920s, this was a huge, you know, boom in the world for industrialization and advancement of technology, and then with that this like loss of nature. And you see that happening quite literally with Isengard, where they're chopping down trees, and which of course has a consequence later, and building like all these cranes and catapults, and they're building the city and breeding such an unnatural army. These, yep, orcs, I don't know about you, anytime I rewatch this, I could not watch the scene of the orcs like bursting out of these like gross amniotic sacs. And I mean, however, like props to the makeup and costume department. because they did such a good job that I am genuinely disgusted. It's nasty.
That whole montage I love, like the music, the shot of like when Gandalf, like the camera just pans down into them, like, you know, throwing the trees in, and then it kind of goes to the orc making or bursting. And yeah. I mean, I'm a big fan of like that sort of thing. Like, I love Alien and I love all those. So like this is on par with that.
Oh, it is very similar to Alien. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's just like the fact that like, you know, like I saw the special features back then, and like, you know, there's people in there, but like, you still believe it. And I think that's so good. And I still believe it when I watch it now. So I always think like, oh, that's so messy. Like, now I just think more practical, because I'm just like, you know, I'm an adult and I have to clean stuff now. And I'm just like, yeah. Oh, that's like muddy and they have to get your stuff in there.
It's yeah. So gross. Like, go shower. Go shower. Go wash yourself. Yeah. Oh, that's gross.
Yeah.
Another fact is that during this scene, the orc blacksmiths are actually Weta Workshop mm-hmm. staff, who Weta Workshop made the weapons for this movie. So I think that's really cool. And there are a lot of other things like that where they got people who like actually know what they're doing to be extras in scenes. So I think that's really cool that like they let them be blacksmith orcs in this movie, because like they actually knew what they were doing with making the weapons and stuff.
Yeah.
So we cut back. Frodo is dying quickly, which is very it's like there's a huge sense of urgency. I think it's like a full chapter and a half in the book, and that like they make comments along the way to Rivendell where they're like, oh hey, I think those are the trolls that Bilbo saw back when he was on his journeys. Isn't that cool? Like, it's a very gradual thing. Here, it's very urgent, very panicking situation. Aragorn tells Sam to look for this weed called Athelas, and Sam's like, yeah, I can go find it. And I don't know why, but I got donkey, blue flower, red thorns vibe when they send.
Yeah, I was like, oh, you're panicking right now. I don't need this. Like, I need
yeah.
Blue flower, red thorns, blue flower, red thorns, blue flower, red thorns. This would be so much easier if I wasn't colorblind.
I really like this moment. Aragorn's looking, and then all of a sudden, someone puts a sword to his throat and is like, huh, is this a ranger who's wandered off too far or something like that?
Ranger cut off his guard.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. Yeah. And like, I love that moment. Here's the thing, Catherine, for your context. Viggo Mortensen as Aragorn, specifically and only as Aragorn, is the love of my life.
Yeah. If you had spoken to like 13-year-old Catherine and like 13 to like 20-year-old Catherine, the same. And then I saw him in an interview one, like, for the, you know, during this thing, I was like, oh, you're a really good actor. I was like, you are not, you're like, he was like so timid and shy, which is like cute in its own way, but I was like, on Aragorn. So that part did take me out of it. When I rewatched the movies, when I saw interviews with him, because I was like, oh, you're not really like that. Like,
I was really surprised and shocked too. It's definitely jarring, to say the least. But yeah, I just love that moment when Arwen puts the sword to his throat and he like looks up and you have this moment of like, uh-oh. And then we have this ethereal slow motion entrance for Arwen, which to me is, I was just like, this is what the male gaze is in this moment. She's lit. She's like in all white. Her hair is flowing. There's this, it's the same effect that they do at a lot of other points in the movies. It's like a sepia tone, slow-mo, like heavenly effect on her, which she's an elf. That makes sense. And this is just, I'm just going to warn listeners, this is just going to be the start of a very arduous relationship for me and Arwen, because like I want to be like, yeah, women supporting women, but just what they do with her character annoys me to no end. And I will rant about it in just a bit. But first, she says that she can take Frodo to Rivendell, and Aragorn is like, I'll take him, you stay with the hobbits. And she says, I can ride faster, I'll take him. And they have this little moment where you're like, oh, so they're together. Okay. Which I kind of like how they set that up here in the movie, because there's none of that in the book. It's very funny how how little setup there is for their relationship in the book. Mm-hmm. But I do like that they just come in and there's this like established history, like a very long history, it sounds like, between them, where they're like super comfortable with each other already and familiar with each other and know how the other person thinks. But they also have a long way to go in their relationship, as we'll see in a different scene.
The fact she was able to put a sword to his neck, I think that was like a very telling moment in their relationship, of like kind of a thing of like joking around, like that sort of thing, like knowing mm-hmm. each other so well mm-hmm. and being able to, because you don't do that to everybody. So
Aragorn's like, okay, take him, and she goes off at the speed of light with Frodo on the horse, and the Nazgul pursue her. And this is, it's like a very cool action sequence, and it's a moment that I feel like her character starts off with a lot of promise for the movies. Immediately occurred to me, I was like, oh, they're kind of like leveling the playing field and showing that like Arwen and Aragorn are equals, basically, and that she is like just as capable of fighting off all these Nazgul as Aragorn is. And she does it on horseback while also carrying a dying hobbit. That's very hard to do. Yeah. And it is a very cool moment for her. And they get to the river, I guess, like outside of Rivendell, and she uses elf magic. It comes up, washes the Nazgul away. There's a moment where I'm kind of confused. Frodo is like moments away from passing out. And does she like transfer some of her elf magic or whatever to him to like keep him alive long enough? I'm not really sure like what goes on there.
I got the feeling that she gave him a little bit of like just a little gist to get him to Riverdale, basically. So I feel Rivendell. I've heard Riverdale. Jesus.
It's okay. I did that when I was reading the books like several times.
It's so fun. Yeah, like the 2020 in there.
Also, I just want to point out one of the Nazgul calls Arwen a she-elf. And I was like, it was like really funny how these thoughts occurred to me like right back to back. I was like, really? Can she not just be an elf? Why does it have to be a she-elf? Literally no one, I don't think in the books, ever calls a female elf she-elf. And then all of a sudden I was like, the Nazgul are evil, old, crusty white men. That makes sense that, like, they would be sexist, you know? Or that they would use a misogynistic term or whatever. So I was like, okay, well, I guess that wraps up those thoughts on that thing for me.
Yeah, and that will come back a little later. Another movie.
Oh my gosh. So Frodo wakes up. He's safe and sound. Gandalf is sitting there. And this is, like... I talked previously about how there's this big character change for Gandalf from the books to the movies, because in the books he's a lot more kind of like stern and serious, and they make him a lot warmer in the movies. I like both of these versions of Gandalf, and I just love, oh my god, him in this scene, it kills me. Frodo is like, where were you? We were supposed to meet in Prancing Pony. Like, where, it's like a kid who got left behind at the grocery store.
Yeah.
And is like, where were you? You didn't come get me. Gandalf could easily just be like, I don't think you understand the ordeal that I have been through. I went to go talk to my trusted advisor, and he betrayed us. He betrayed all of us. He beat down on me, and this was another moment for me, Catherine, that really took me out, was that wizard fight.
Yeah, that I will say that's always been a little like, eh.
That one's, it's a little bit too silly.
Yeah.
But instead of going into this very long, sad story about how he was completely betrayed by someone he trusted, he was kept prisoner, he is like on top of this tower for, I don't know, probably a week now at this point, I don't know how long it is, and has to like make this grand escape, and instead he looks at Frodo, and there's this look in his eyes, oh, it's so good, and he just says like, I was delayed. You just hear the sadness in his voice, because he doesn't want to like burden Frodo with that. Yeah. That like, I was captured by Saruman, and I don't think you realize that it wasn't my fault. And he just says, I was delayed, because he doesn't want to burden Frodo with that, because Frodo's already been burdened with so much at that point.
You've given me a really good, because that I want to say that now, like I've watched these movies so many times where like I kind of know the dialogue, but sometimes when I'm rewatching them, I'm like, oh, like I understand even now, like I still see things a little differently, or like now that I'm older, experience different things, I like it hits differently. And now that you say like, mm-hmm. I was delayed, I was like, oh, that's my adult working life. Like, I'm going to use that next time. like we were delayed.
I was delayed.
Yeah. I was like, don't even ask.
The other thing though, is that like in the book, this was almost like a comedic moment for me, because it was a thing of like, you were delayed. You like straight up didn't show up when you like, I think that's an understatement, dude. Like, it's a bit comedic because it's so like, there's so much more to that than just I was delayed.
Yeah. But the way that, I mean, Sir Ian McKellen like delivers that line is, oh,
it's so, so good. Yeah. So good. The way he like, he puts so much feeling and meaning into three words. It's so good.
Yeah.
And we get a little flashback to what happened. Saruman comes up to the tower like one last time to basically be like, are you gonna join me? You need to join us. And Gandalf is like, takes a stand against him. And Saruman says a line that I think is a meme. He says, so you have chosen death. And that's something that like I've seen people share a lot on the internet for something, I don't know. Gandalf like falls off the tower. The eagle comes and gets him, and they fly over beautiful New Zealand scenery. Oh. Again, Peter Jackson is lucky the country of New Zealand exists. Yeah, and then we cut back to Frodo's like, Gandalf, hello? And he's like, yeah, sorry about that. I was just having like a traumatic flashback, but don't worry about it. This thing's more important. Elrond comes in, and I have to say, so here's the thing is like, I never really thought about what Elrond looked like as I was reading it, but Hugo Weaving is not what I imagined.
Yeah.
He has such a big forehead in this.
It's sort of like a, I don't know if you saw The Mummy Return, like the second one in the original, like Brendan Fraser one, but the Scorpion King, which is the Rock, where they like at the very end, spoiler, but he has like his hairline, and all they do is like add like a little like a lot, it's like horrible, and it's like CGI, and so that kind of reminds me of this thing, like you should have done something else.
However, we almost, as I'm like reading trivia, there's a lot of like, oh, Nicolas Cage was almost Aragorn, or Russell Crowe was almost Aragorn, or whatever. I'm not sure about the Nicolas Cage one, now that I think about it. I think Russell Crowe actually was almost Aragorn. But David Bowie was almost Elrond.
Ooh, that would have been a good one.
Can you imagine? That's crazy. But they ultimately decided, they're like, I don't think we can have someone this big and famous in this important of a role.
Yeah.
It was like a hat on a hat. We can't have two big things. We gotta pick one or the other.
Although, like for me, that was also like 1999 was The Matrix, like the first one. And so I kept thinking, I think when I saw this, I was like, Mr. Anderson, you know, like, because it was just like, that was trippy for me. So it's always never really, not that he's wrong for the role. It's just, you can tell.
Yeah, like, he's perfectly fine. He just, I don't, no offense to Hugo Weaving, but he just doesn't really look like an elf to me. Like, you look at Orlando Bloom and you're like, that's an elf.
Yeah.
Frodo reunites with Merry and Pippin and Sam, and he also reunites with Bilbo. And despite the fact that I have read the books and I have seen Fellowship of the Ring now at least a couple times, I was like genuinely like, Bilbo, yeah, it's you. And this happened every time in the books too, whenever they're reunited with him. I get so happy whenever you run into Bilbo, because it's like, it's just like a reminder, you know, you're far away from home and it's a comfort from home. And Bilbo has been writing his adventures,
yeah,
The Hobbit, there and back again, which is like a fun little Easter egg, I guess, for people. Because at this point, you know, it was just The Lord of the Rings were the movies. They hadn't made The Hobbit movies yet, mm-mm, which I know are terrible, but I will be covering those in a couple months.
Yeah.
But yeah, at the time, they were like, we don't know if we're going to get to make The Hobbit, so let's put in as many like fun Easter eggs to Bilbo's adventures as we can.
And for me, it was really cool because I had that, The Hobbit was very much in my mind from the movie and the cartoon, and then seeing, going to Lord of the Rings, and I think back then I probably knew Bilbo's story like really well, and like just knowing, like, you know, when you know more about that and like why that's there, it's just so much fun. So mm-hmm. I think that was like a nice little ode for people who did know about The Hobbit.
Yeah. Oh, it's funny, The Hobbit, the Sam and Frodo are like, oh wow, it's so great that we brought the ring here, we did our job, it'll be great to go home. There's this fun little Easter egg from the books, if you have the subtitles on, when Frodo first walks up to Sam as he's packing his bag, Sam is talking, he's like muttering under his breath, and he's like, oh, I forgot rope. And this is something that is like a plot point in the book. When they leave Rivendell, Sam like goes over in detail all the things that he packed in his bag, and he's basically like the Mary Poppins of the group, because he packed like anything he thinks they could be prepared for, but all of a sudden he remembers, he's like, oh, I forgot rope, I hope we don't ever need rope again. And then eventually they do. Oh, and it's a whole thing.
Yes.
So I just appreciate those small details of like, this was a thing in the books that they took directly, and you know, they didn't make it a whole thing, but it's just like a fun Easter egg for people who had read the books to be like, oh, there's Sam obsessing over rope and packing his bags.
Oh, good old Samwise.
And then enter the rest of the Fellowship.
Oh, yes, my life changed forever.
We get like close-up entrances of Boromir. Yes. And Gimli and some other dwarves and Legolas and some other elves. And it's just kind of like, oh my God, they're here. The story is, it's about to get, you know, for people who have seen it before or know the story, they know what's about to come. And you're like, ah, yes, more of these characters. I can't wait for this. Elrond and Gandalf have a little chat about what's going on. And Elrond is basically like, we can't keep the ring here. Just before was the scene of Frodo and Sam being like, we got the ring to the elves and that's all we had to do. The end, our part is over. And then Elrond's like, we can't have the ring here because we have both Isengard and Mordor, Sauron, looking at us, and it won't be safe here. We also can't have it because it will corrupt us. We get some more exposition, which the movies do a lot better than the books, because in the books it's just like the first 50 pages. It's just like all backstory and exposition, and here they really intersperse it a lot better.
Yeah.
And Elrond talks about how I believe this is another meme. He's like, you weren't there. Like, don't tell me what I don't do and don't know. I was there the day the strength of men failed.
Yeah.
and talks about how he was there when Isildur couldn't throw the ring into Mordor and destroy it. Yeah. And so you like learned that backstory of like, okay, so that's why we can't give the ring to basically anyone, because it'll corrupt them. Like, even yeah. And it's a great line, he says, men are weak. And I'm like, yeah.
Yeah. It's funny because such a good way to utilize those flashbacks. And I know, like, I guess probably a few years, which is 2004, was one of my favorite TV shows, which I think is a precursor to a lot of like also Game of Thrones and everything, which I think Lord of the Rings also has stemmed. I don't know, it's like a lot of influence. Mm-hmm. But like the flashbacks of just giving you a little bit to like give you context to what's going on, in a way that, like you said, in the book it's probably a little bit confusing or whatever, or it would be too much to like just throw at, or yeah. It would probably be a little boring as well. So they just give you these little nuggets of like you wanting to know more, but yet you learn a lot within that little montage. And it's really cool. And then you're like, oh, I want to know more about that. But it's like, oh, for a later time.
So then we have a cut to this like very weird scene. And I don't think it's necessarily needed. It's again a moment when I'm like, when people are like, how is Lord of the Rings so long? I'm like, I can point to this scene and be like, because they did this. Boromir comes in. Aragorn is like sitting in the corner reading somewhere because, oh, I should say, they do some like very not so subtle foreshadowing with the way that a character will say a line and then they cut to the character basically that line is subtextually about. Mm-hmm. And they did this where Gandalf and Elrond are like, but who can save us? And Gandalf says like, well, there is one person who can unite us all. And Elrond is like, he walked away from that life. He chose exile. Cut to Aragorn.
Yeah. That's a good old 2000s storytelling.
And he is like just sitting in a courtyard reading a book. And then Boromir walks in. they have this like very weird stare down and have like intense eye contact. And to me, it's just like, this is a dick measuring contest. Boromir is just like immediately measuring up this random guy that he doesn't know is Aragorn yet. He's just like, this is a random ranger who's here. And he picks up the shards of Narsil, which is the blade that broke. And then Isildur used the broken blade to cut off Sauron's finger. And it's still broken. And it's lying here in Rivendell in pieces. And this is a really interesting thing that is a total diversion from the books. Because in the books, Aragorn shows up to Rivendell and he has the broken blade with him. When they leave Rivendell, the sword is reforged and they barely mention it at all. And he just has the sword and that's it. Like that's all, and it was something that as I was reading the books, I was like, that's a really like weird anticlimactic thing, because I don't think I brought it up in the previous episode when Aragorn is introduced, but they also don't do his famous poem in the book, which is the "Not all those who wander are lost" poem. And it's like very foundational, I guess, to his character. And it basically tells you exactly who this kid is. It talks about like the blade being reforged and the king returning. And it's basically his entire backstory and fate and destiny in one poem. And they don't have that. I think maybe there's one line that is spoken in by a different character in Return of the King. So it's just like so weird how this is a total like deviation from the books.
Yeah,
I guess it makes for an interesting moment that obviously I'll get more in depth in Return of the King. You know, it's not necessarily a change that I hate. I don't mind this change, because when I was reading it, like I said, I was like, that seems kind of weird and anticlimactic that they would like make this whole to-do about the broken blade and the sword reforged, and then they just did it without any pomp and circumstance.
Yeah. But I also think, well, for me, I don't mind the length of the movie. I think I've always liked longer movies if they're interesting enough. And like this world, when I was watching it for the first time, I was so in awe with everything that I was like, I wanted more. You know, I would have watched 6 hours of it, which I did in the extended version. But it really speaks to like the Boromir loss that, you know, we're going to get eventually. And I think these little moments, especially with Sean Bean being so, like he has such a presence, and we're going to learn later on his career, you know, like that it is very true. You just need that little bit to really, I think if there wasn't enough of Boromir in these little scenes, especially with Aragorn and the way he feels about like men and everything and like not taking responsibility. And then you have someone like Boromir who's very much like wants to lead, but he's not the right leader. It just makes it such more like more impactful in the end of the fellowship with whatever happens. Maybe they felt that they needed to keep those moments, even though this one is a little bit odd, but it's really showing like the history, Gondor, Aragorn, what he's not going towards.
Yeah. My thing is that like I can get all of that from what happens in the Council of Elrond scene. So for me, this moment where Boromir comes in and is like judging Aragorn, and although it does make for like a fun, awkward moment in the Council of Elrond, I don't know. I guess I just don't really need this scene again. But that's also hard for me because like I can't just take out all of the knowledge that I have from the books and be like, but would I also have those feelings if I was just coming into the movies with no books, you know? But Boromir picks up the blade and like pokes himself and bleeds, and I'm like, good job, buddy. Okay, I will say it is a very good job of like, you immediately get a vibe for this dude and it's not great.
Yeah. I think that's what like it's establishing is like, because in the council, like everyone gets their little bit, but like I think they needed to put extra emphasis on him because of what happens, you know, later on, and the fact that like you can tell he's a good dude, you know, obviously he's trying to fight for Middle Earth, but you can tell that the way he's going to get there or the way he would go about it is not necessarily the right way, as you know, standing next to Aragorn, who you know is probably going to do more of the right thing that we've learned, you know, in the little bit that we learn.
Yeah, I really like the way that you put it, how, you know, Aragorn is meant to be the leader, but he's not ready to step into that role yet. And then here comes Boromir, who's like desperate to lead people, and he's just not the right person for it at all. And these are like total opposite people, basically. He drops it, and then when he like walks away, Aragorn picks it up and puts it back on its place and does like, I think, a sign of the cross or something. Something like that, which obviously is you're like, okay, so this sword is very important to his character and who he is. And then Arwen comes in. Basically, it's a whole talk about so Aragorn he's not wanting to accept his fate of being this king and this leader, and he's not ready for that, and he's not ready to take this blade and, you know, make it anew and do what he's supposed to do. Arwen also start talking about their relationship. And so this is really where, for me, she really falls flat as a character. Like I said, they had a really promising start with her, where she comes in, she's out and about on her own. She has a sword. She's doing, I guess, ranger-y type things on her own in the woods. And she saves Frodo. She has this really cool action sequence. But I feel like that was just, they made that scene and they're like, okay, cool. So we made an amazing feminist icon, didn't we? We showed her in one action scene. We don't have to do anything else with her for the rest of these movies. Also, the entire time, her character is only in relation to men. It's never Arwen is Arwen for Arwen's sake.
Yeah.
I don't know how to say that. It's always she comes in and she saves Frodo and saves all these other, saves Aragorn and the other hobbits. She's saving these men. And then she comes in and she serves as the love interest for the rest of the story and is basically only there to save Aragorn in various situations.
Yeah.
And it's very, I get what the movie, the writers and producers and directors were trying to do with this, because they read the story and they're like, this is bad. There's two female characters. We can't have two. I know, let's bump up Arwen's character and have her be in more scenes. And
yeah.
And it just really falls flat for me.
Yeah, it always bugged me that she was an elf, you know, and obviously immortal. And I was like, why do you have to give that up? In my very 13-year-old brain, because there was no terms back then, from when I grew up, of male gaze, female gaze. I didn't know any of that. Mm-hmm. I was accepting what they were giving me, but that's all you know. And then now when I look back at movies I saw when I was younger, I was like, ooh, that was bad, you know. Or TV shows. But and so that's why it's also kind of, when I hear people, I guess maybe Gen Z people, who are like, oh, this is the worst thing, it's in the context, you had to have lived in it, and it wasn't necessarily bad, but now we know better, you know. And
yeah.
And even then, what I was seeing on screen, her giving up her immortality would not have matched what I would have done as even a 13-year-old girl. So it was still the screen, on screen stuff was not the representation necessarily of my real life, which is probably still happening today. Right. But it's just funny, because I always thought I'm going to get with this guy, Aragorn, maybe eventually, I would have lived a good life, had his baby, I don't know, whatever, you know. And then, I'm going to go on about my, because I think, I don't know when it is, Elrond has I don't know if it's another movie, so I'm sorry if I'm spoiling it, but
No, that's okay. It all kind of blends together.
Yeah,
at
it does.
Point,
Yeah, I've seen this over 100 times, so I'm I don't know. But he's telling her, you're going to have to see him get old and die and all this stuff. And to me, I was just the fact that they were framing it in that way, you're going to have to live alone, that seemed, now that I think about it, that's the kind of male shit. It was you're going to live alone? Why would you do that?
Yeah.
You know?
And a woman being unmarried, unheard of.
Yeah. And so that was to me, it never meshed, no matter what. I accepted it, I went with it or whatever, but I was just thinking, I want to live forever. I don't want to die. Especially when you're a little kid, you don't want to die at all, you know? So that's really scary. And so me, I was like, why are you doing that?
I think something that just really annoys me, and it was something as I was reading the books too, is when I would bring up this point of the female representation is terrible, and people would be like, well, for the time it was really great. And I'm like, that's fine, but we're talking about it in the context now of 2020. Mm-hmm. And the context of 2020 is that this is not good representation. That's fine and dandy for 50 years ago, but it's not great for now. And we need to, you know, it's just a sign for us that for people who create works of fiction going forward, that we need to continue to do better.
Yeah.
Real quick, I wanted to find for the listeners listeners who didn't, I was a women and gender studies minor in college. So like these terms are very second nature to me. So for people who didn't study feminism in college, I want to define the male gaze for you real quickly. Just literally the Wikipedia definition as I typed into Google. The male gaze is the act of depicting women and the world in the visual arts and in literature from a masculine heterosexual perspective that presents and represents women as a sexual object for pleasure of the male viewer. So I wouldn't necessarily say that like, oh, they overly sexualized the characters, but it's definitely presented in a way as like they exist only in relation to heterosexual men characters in this movie.
So. Well, I mean, like Supergirl was like basically crop top and like her first scene was in a bikini. Like it was just like, it was really bad.
Yeah, it's I think another way to put it is that like the male gaze is what happens when movie creators create a female character as if the straight man is the default audience member.
Yeah.
And they are targeting that directly to the straight male audience member.
Yeah. Yeah. I would always think in the action movies or something, I'd be like, that looks so uncomfortable to like fight in, you know?
Yeah.
Why would you wear that?
And like, yeah. So that's what happened. Listeners, that's why like in action movies, the women are in these like tight suits that has zero actual protective quality to them. And you're like, there's no way you could fight in that. And you would immediately, that offers no protection. What is wrong with you?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So now that we've had a crash course in feminism.
Yeah. We digress.
Yeah, they have this conversation about her immortality, which it's an interesting thing for me because I'm like, okay, on one hand, her body, her choice, if she wants to, because she does have a good line of like, and Aragorn does say, it's not an instance of he's asking her to give up her immortality.
He never does that. Yeah.
He says the opposite. He's like, I would never ask that of you. That's way too big. And she says, it's mine to give. It's up to me to decide whether or not I want to give up my immortality. You know, I respect that choice. It's not the choice I would go with. And I'm just thinking about like, man, if I was an elf, are you kidding me? I would never in my life give up immortality for a dumb boy. I mean, even if it is Aragorn.
I think I'm trying to think, well, I'm sure people will be asking, well, what do you want then, right? Thinking about it now, given the fact that Aragorn is Aragorn and he's so like, he's not forcing her to give up this. It's nothing like that. And that's what makes him so much more like, oh my God, you're so hot. is I feel like later on, maybe at the end of the like Return of the King kind of thing, maybe been where he would have been a character to maybe want her to move on. So he knows that his legacy of what he does would actually be fulfilled because he could trust her to really like see that through and see like if they have children and stuff. And so to me, that would make more sense of like, you know, and then she would, given the fact that she loves him so much, obviously, she would honor that wish because she's going to be immortal. And so to me, that would make more of a like maybe a modern sort of retelling of like, hey, you don't have to give this up because you are who you are.
Like he can like pass the mantle onto her, like, you know, pass the torch on once he's gone so she can, you know,
make sure it stays fulfilled. Yeah. So that would also give her like an equal footing of like they are equals. It's just going to be unequal because he's going to be king because of his legacy. But she is part of that because she's going to be able to like really, you know, use all the knowledge, which I think I've seen in some like other stuff, like a remnants of that. But like to me, thinking about what we would want, because that's always a question like, well, what do you guys want? You know, and then so it's just like that would be in terms of like a story wise also really good, not just like a feminist type thing. But that makes more sense to me, given the fact that Aragorn is so moral and, you know, is so fearful of what's to come, that why wouldn't he want someone that he could trust like 100 and 200%, you know?
Yeah, I really love that. That's like a great like alternative, you know, ending for this storyline and this character. That's like really, that's really awesome. Thank you for like thinking of that and bringing that up. That's really cool.
Yeah.
Then we get to the Council of Elrond. In the book, it's such a chapter. It's like 30 plus pages. There's all these characters being introduced. Literally every person that talks is giving this like deep backstory of like, here's how I got to where I am now. So given all that, it doesn't surprise me that the Council of Elrond scene was rewritten several times, but they kept, like, every time they would rewrite it, it kept getting too long and too expository. Is that expository.
I think, yeah.
Is that, am I saying that word right?
Expository.
Whatever. Too much exposition. And they even rewrote it as they were filming it. So there's a part of Boromir's speech where Sean Bean is reading it from a paper in his lap, because he had like just gotten it the night before. So I just think that's like that doesn't surprise me at all, because it's such a hefty chapter. And when I was reading the book, I was imagining like, how the heck do they do this in the movie? There's so much happening. And they just kind of got to a point where they're like, we can't do everything that happens in this chapter. We yeah. just have to pare it down to essentials only for this.
Which they did a good job, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. And Elrond gives this speech, and he's talking about like the future of what's going to happen. He's like, we are either going to unite as one, and then it cuts to Aragorn as Elrond is talking, or we will fail, and then it cuts to Boromir.
Very emphasized.
Yeah, it's like super, super heavy foreshadowing. When Frodo places the ring down, it's so interesting to see that Boromir is immediately, he like leans in and immediately he goes, "'Tis a gift." And you're just like, oh no, this is, I don't know. I don't like this guy.
Yeah.
Also, Catherine, for your context, reading the books, Boromir was one of my least favorite characters.
I think I can tell.
Yeah, I do not like Boromir. And everyone kept saying like, oh, he's so much better in the movies. Not really. There's like one or two moments where I'm like, I get why people say he's not that bad. But it doesn't redeem everything yeah. that happens.
Although, will you say, I guess I would ask this just because I love Sean Bean as an actor. He always kind of plays these characters where you know he's kind of like shady, yet you know he has good within him. And so, you know, mm-hmm. he'll have these like redemptive qualities sometimes. So how did you feel like watching him?
Yeah, so he honestly was, his performance in this, especially, I think maybe like just with those moments where like he's clearly being tempted by the ring to use it, and he just has the wrong idea of what to do when he's like super misguided, I guess, for those moments specifically. His performance is almost like cartoonish. It's very, to me, at least for me, and like I'm really sorry for people who love Sean Bean, but his performance like didn't really blow me away. He is really great in, I don't mean this to be mean, he is really great when he's dying.
Yeah, no, yeah.
No, but like that's a really, you know, that's a really good moment. And I do like a lot of other moments for him, but it's just like very over the top. I would almost say that like it almost reads more as like a stage performance mm-hmm. for him, because when you are a stage actor, you have to be very big because you have to make sure the people in the back row can like feel and see your performance. Mm-hmm. So when you come to a screen and in movies, you have to like really tone that down. So it almost feels like he played this role as a play and then came in and they didn't tell him to tone it down.
Yeah, I can see that too. Maybe the fact that like, you know his character later, like he is playing against his type a little bit, although he has played these kind of like shady folks in like Mission Impossible and stuff like that. So maybe it was also sort of that thing, like it was just too much. But I can see both ways, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So he is immediately drawn in and taken over by the ring. And he is like, we should use it. And Aragorn, which he'll bring up time and time again. And Aragorn is like, did you not just, we have to destroy it. This is not good. We have to destroy it. And Boromir is like, and who do you think you are? And Legolas stands up and defends his friend and goes, this is Aragorn. That is no mere ranger. That is Aragorn, son of Arathorn, king of Gondor.
Oh my goodness.
And Boromir is like, you are no king of mine. Gondor has no king.
So good. Wait, can we just go on a side tangent of Legolas? Oh man, I don't know how long your episode's going to be, but 13-year-old or whatever, 12, 13-year-old cat, like I was obsessed with freaking Legolas. So much so, like I, and then of course I got into Orlando Bloom And then he was in Pirates of the Caribbean, I think like a few years later. Yeah. And it was like, oh my God, I freaking love Orlando Bloom. So I was like totally obsessed. I remember I had like, I bought like calendars and like I had like all his like, I just took the calendar, like the photos of him from the calendar, put it all on my wall.
Oh my gosh. Did you get like inserts from magazines?
Yeah. Oh
like,
yeah.
Fold it out into posters.
Yeah, I would do all of that. And then it's funny because back then we had AIM, which is AOL Instant Messenger. Mm-hmm. And my screen name was like Lego Cat, because it was like Catherine, you know, cat, and then like Legolas. Yeah. And then and then I had my first Yahoo email address was like obcat21 because it was Orlando Bloom and then cat because, you know, we're gonna get married, right, whatever. So and so I still like use that to this day, and it's funny because like it always just brings back those memories of like I was so, you know, like when you're a girl, you're like just writing down like Orlando Bloom and stuff, and it's just like Legolas was, I guess, maybe my like first really intense on-screen crush or something. But I mean I'm sure he was for so many.
That's so fantastic. Yeah. That's great.
I loved him so much.
Yeah. Orlando Bloom, he was born to play an elf. He is like, he's so good in this role. Like just his movements, he just looks like an elf. And he was actually cast in this role 2 days before he graduated from drama school. Let's see. Yeah. So Legolas gets up, defends Aragorn. There's this like awkward eye contact moment of Boromir and Aragorn where Boromir's like, I probably shouldn't have had that weird moment with you and the Blade of Narsil, but oh well. Oh, and then what's really funny is that like right as I was wondering, as they're talking about the ring needs to be destroyed, blah, 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 it occurred to me, I was like, well, what would happen if you just like took an axe to it? And then literally like as I thought that, Gimli jumps up. He's like, well then, what are we waiting for? Charges at it, hits it with an axe, and is like blown back. His axe is blown apart, and that's your the moment where you're like, first, it's a what a way to introduce Gimli.
Yes.
I love that introduction for him. And two, you're like, oh, this is intense. This isn't good. I should note that Elrond says, calm down, Gimli, son of Gloin. And Catherine, the pronunciation of Gimli's father's name was very debated as I was reading it, because a lot of people were like, it's not pronounced Gloin as in groin. Are you kidding me? No, it's Gloin, because there's an accent over the I.
Oh.
And I always pronounced it as Gloin. And I had some guests who were like, yeah, it's Gloin. And then other ones who were like, no, it's Gloin. And you know what? The movie said Gloin. We're all going with Gloin.
You know, and I subconsciously always think groin and like do a little giggle. So I'm like, I'll keep it Gloin.
I know. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. And yeah, Elrond's like, okay, who's gonna take it to Mordor? Dead silence.
I will take it. I will take it.
And everyone like bursts up and starts arguing because I think Legolas maybe offers to take it or do something, and Gimli's like, I'll die before it's left in the hand of an elf. And then they start fighting, and Aragorn and Boromir have been fighting over this Gondor stuff that's going on in the background, and Frodo stands up and says, I will take it.
Yes.
And at first no one hears him because he's so little. And then he says it again, and it's another moment of Ian McKellen being great, because you see him like sigh and have this like overcoming wave of sadness of like, I don't want this for you. And you like, what a brave little hobbit to stand up and say, I will take it. And everyone goes silent and they turn around and look at him and goes, I will take it, though I do not know the way.
Yeah. Oh. It's kind of like the equivalent of, although it's like nowhere near as poignant, but the I Volunteer's tribute sort of thing that we see later with Katniss Everdeen in the Hunger Games. It's like that sort of like...
Yeah, it's really reminiscent of that. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think she even like mutters under... At first she says like, I volunteer, kind of like under her breath. The same thing kind of happens with Frodo, where like he all of a sudden he has this realization in the moment where he's like, I will take it. And yeah, Katniss does the same thing where she's like, I volunteer. And then she realizes what she just did. And then she stands up and is like, I volunteer as tribute. And then Sam jumps up. He was listening in a bush and is like, I'm going with him. And Elrond is like, well, I would imagine so, considering that you weren't invited to this meeting and you came anyway. And then Merry and Pippin pop their little heads out of columns and they're like, we're coming too. And this look on Elrond's face as they come running over, he's like, oh my god, the hobbits are just so hobbity, like too hobbity for their own good.
Oh, yes.
And Pippin has this great line where he's like, you need people of intelligence on a mission quest thing. And Merry goes, he's like, well, then why are you here, Pip?
Yeah, he's like, that rules you out.
yeah, that's what he says. Yeah. And then there's this, Elrond. He's like, you shall be the Fellowship of the Ring. Triumphant music. And then Pippin's like, all right. So where are we going?
Yeah, it's so cute.
It's so good.
Oh.
Hello, it's Mary Clay from the future here to say, Catherine and I made a grave mistake when we were talking about this section of the movie, because we didn't even mention the you have my sword, my bow, and my axe. And that just had to do with the fact that we were just so in love with the hobbits during this scene, and we completely just forgot to talk about that moment. But I had to insert myself here and say I realized it pretty much immediately as soon as we finished recording, and so this is the official appreciation for that moment. Okay, now onward.
Before Frodo leaves, he has a little talk with Bilbo. Bilbo gives him some of his stuff from his adventure in The Hobbit. He gives him Sting, which conveniently glows blue when orcs are nearby, and gives him his old chainmail that is made of mithril, which is like dwarf silver that's in the mines of Moria deep, basically. And it's super strong material that will basically protect him. I'm sure that won't come in handy. There's a moment where Bilbo sees the ring hanging around Frodo's neck, and he like goes to reach for it, and Frodo's like, no. And Bilbo goes demon mode for a second. It's very terrifying.
Ooh, yeah. That
question for you, since you were little when you saw that, did that like scare you?
Yeah, I did. Yeah. I still remember the moment. Like, I would have the lights out, which now I don't anymore, I guess, when I watch stuff. So maybe that's why I did that. And it was like generally like for a 12-year-old who, I don't know how many scary movies I had seen prior to that, I would get a little like, oh, maybe I should pause it and go hang out with my mom a little or something.
It's like a really, it's also like, it's just very random, because this movie isn't really, they don't really go for the jump scares.
No.
But they really went for this one. And so yeah, it's just like,
it does seem out of place a little bit too, with like the visual effect of it. Like it was kind of out of place. And I think that's why also you're like, oh, is this kind of movie or what? Like, yeah, what's going on?
And Bilbo has this like really sad moment where he breaks down. He's like, I'm sorry that I had to do this to you. Oh. And it's like just, it's just really sad. And I don't even think Frodo responds to that. He's just kind of like, yeah.
He's like, oh, shy.
Me too. All right, guys, it's happening again. More traveling, more walking in beautiful scenery.
Oh my God. So beautiful.
And then thus begins, they use the same musical theme over and over anytime there's like a remotely triumphant moment for the Fellowship. Great, but they literally use it anytime anything good happens. So it kind of like takes it away. I don't know. I guess I'd compare it to like in the Marvel movies when you hear that Avengers theme come in, like they use it sparingly on purpose so that when it comes in, it has lots of meaning behind it. And you're like, oh, right, this is awesome. They pick like three musical themes to use over and over again in the movies.
Yeah, I'm too muddled of like nostalgia where I, when I was rewatching it for this, I was like, oh, that music. And I was so obsessed, and I was in band, but we like played that theme, and I was a clarinet for one of our concerts. And I was just like, I was so happy. And I think I don't know if I like annoyed them to death, but like, yes, we're doing Lord of the Rings. And so
I definitely like that theme, and it's a good theme.
Yeah, I get it.
It was just one of those things that like, I all of a sudden realized, I was like, wait a minute, they kind of use that a lot. And then it was as soon as I noticed that, you know, I couldn't unhear that. So there's this like really great scene that it's, we don't really get any of this in the books, where they're just, the fellowship is just hanging out. They've like stopped to rest. Boromir's teaching Merry and Pippin how to fight. Aragorn's sitting there like giving some tips. Gimli and Gandalf are talking about which way to go. Gimli's like, let's go to Moria. My cousin lives there. And Legolas is being an elf. Sam and Frodo are eating, cooking food and eating. It's just like a great, it's just like a really nice moment of like, oh, they're like all, they're starting to be friends, this little fellowship group. And then the birds come in. Legolas is like,
there's his little squid. Yeah,
you can see his eyes. he looks around, yeah. And you're like, oh, Legolas, what do you see? What do you see, dude? Yeah, these spies of Saruman come flying over. They all hide. Saruman finds out that they are traveling this way, obviously. Also, speaking of Saruman, I want to mention, so Sir Christopher Lee, the actor who played Saruman, he passed away, I think, in 2015. He, like, very religiously read Lord of the Rings and loved it. And knew a lot about the lore and everything and had a lot of extensive knowledge about it. And he was also the only cast member to have met J.R.R. Tolkien. Mm. So I just think that's like really cool. And it's also like so unsuspecting for the character of Saruman that like the guy who played the nerd was the one who had all this background knowledge. Like it would have been really cool if it was like, oh, Aragorn or Elrond or Gandalf had that background. But nope, it was Saruman. And he sends a blizzard their way. This is another great Legolas elf moment because they're all trudging through the snow.
He's just like gliding.
This is what happens in the books too. He like prances on top of the snow because he is, well, he doesn't prance in the book, but basically, I mean, in the movie, but basically in the book, he is like so light on his feet. And I think he even like laughs at them at one point in the book. And it's like a really great moment and like a small detail for his character that they bring into the movies. So I like that like you can see him just like walking on top of the snow, having no troubles at all. And everyone else is just trudging along.
Which is another reason why I was like, why would you give up your elfness and your immortality? Because I wanted to be like Legolas. So I was just like, ugh.
I know. Exactly. Eventually, they're like, Gandalf, this is insane. We can't go this way. We have to do something else. They can't go through the Gap of Rohan because that brings them too close to Isengard. And Gandalf says, let the ring bearer decide. Mm-hmm. And Frodo says, we'll go to the mines of Moria.
Yes. That was a little shady of Gandalf, actually, because he knew he would choose that, but he didn't want to be the one.
Yeah, so the reason Gandalf is so desperate to not go into the Mines of Moria is because through these like flashbacks, we see what Saruman and him were talking about and what Saruman has told him. And Gandalf, I think this is something that like is kind of left to be ambiguous in the books, but in the movies, Gandalf knows what is in Moria. He knows that there's this Balrog and there's this like ancient evil that the dwarves have woke. They woke up this ancient evil, and he knows that it's in Moria, and he does not want to go there. And Saruman is even like, you know that it will bring about your end. And Gandalf doesn't want to go that way. Yeah, he leaves it up to Frodo, and Frodo's like, we'll go to Moria. And Gandalf is like, crap. So they get to Moria. There's the beautiful lit up elvish door. There's a little riddle. What's funny is that in the book, when I was reading it, I was like, oh, is this going to be some dumb riddle where the answer is friend? And then it is, because it's speak friend and enter. And I was like, I immediately picked up on that. I was like, yes, say friend in Elvish or whatever. While they're waiting for Gandalf to solve this riddle, Sam says goodbye to Bill the Pony. I bring this up because he is a very beloved character in the books. And maybe he has a more of an introduction in an extended edition scene. He's not really introduced. And I think this is all we see of Bill the Pony. Because in the books, they're reunited with him. So we say goodbye to Bill the Pony. Bill, we hardly knew ye. Pippin is just throwing rocks into the river.
A good old Pip.
And Aragorn's like, stop that.
Like children. Oh, and yes. big brothers and children.
Exactly, yeah. And then finally, Frodo is like, hey, do we think it's friend? And Gandalf says the elvish word for friend. They open Moria. Gimli is stoked. And then it's immediately sharp left turn because I find out all the dwarves inside are dead. There were goblin attacks. And right as they're like, get out of here, we need to leave, the watcher in the lake, which is basically like a kraken octopus type thing, reaches out and grabs Frodo. And there's this mad dash as like everyone's trying to get out of Moria. And then they're also trying to save Frodo. This is again a moment where the special effects don't really hold up very well. It kind of reminds me of the scene in Prisoner of Azkaban movie when Harry and Hermione are being thrown around by the Whomping Willow.
And
it's like a little campy. Actually, let me rephrase this. It kind of feels to me like they meant for this to be a section where like you put on 3D glasses, because there are a lot of moments where like the tentacles kind of come up towards the camera and Frodo's like tossed into the air. I mean, again, though, you know, it's not like they really could have done any better than this for the time.
Yeah,
so they all say Frodo. They go running inside just as I think what happens is like the watcher, it hits the mountain and it knocks down and they are enclosed into Moria. And they're like, well, there's no turning back now. And what's really interesting here is that the use of like sound editing for this is so notable, because it goes like it goes completely quiet and you really feel like you're enclosed in a cave, and it sounds like it, and it's just like a really good use of atmosphere to make you feel like you're trapped in the darkness with them. Also, just want to give a quick shout out to Gimli, because he's going through it during this part of the movie, because he is finding out that finds out later too with Balin that all of his family and friends, like a lot of people he knows, are dead. And it's like such a tragic way for him to find out. And it's like really, it's almost kind of like glossed over because so much is happening around him. So John Rhys-Davies is the actor who plays Gimli. And this is what kind of just, so like he's great in the role and I love it. It's great. However, he is 6'1".
Yeah.
So obviously they had to use a body double for him. And he is also, he was allergic to the makeup that they used for him. So every time he would go in and get the makeup done, he would have to take a day in between filming so that his face would like go back to normal. At that point, I'm like, okay, maybe this kind of goes into, I think we know better now that maybe you should have gotten an actor of a different, you know, differently abled body actor, you know, to give those actors a chance, because there are actors with different abilities and disabilities that are trying to make it. And this would have been a great opportunity for a little person who is not Warwick Davis to get a role in a fantasy genre.
Yeah.
And I just think it's like a really interesting decision for them that like they really made it harder on themselves, because he's 6'1" and he's, aside from The Hobbit, supposed to be like the smallest person in the Fellowship.
Yeah, that's a really good point, because I mean, we obviously, there's really great actors. Peter Dinklage, who I know I bring up Game of Thrones a lot, but it's sort of the same fantasy realm, and he's one of my favorite actors because he's so good. And like, it would have been different, because I think he also, like, it would have to been, I don't know if he would have been the right age, but I'm sure there's like tons of actors, you know, that could have done those roles. So that's actually interesting, because I hadn't thought about that.
Mm-hmm. And, maybe they did audition a bunch of different people, and this is just the person they landed on as being right for the role. I don't know what that process was, but I just think it's like really interesting that like not only was he 6'1", but he was allergic to the makeup. And I'm like, I feel like at that point I would have been like, hey, bud, we tried to make it work, but you got to tap out. You know, we have to keep the production schedule moving. We can't stop every time you have an allergic reaction.
Yeah.
I mean, but that being said, John Rhys-Davies is really great in this role, and he like brings a lot of gusto to the role. So I do appreciate him for that. As they're walking through Moria, Gandalf lights the way with his little flashlight staff. They get to a point where I think this is another meme. Oh my gosh. You know what I totally glossed over? One does not simply.
Oh, yeah. The meme. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. I forgot to bring that up. Yeah, one does not simply.
Because he has two. He has the is a gift. And then it was
is
like.
Is a gift. Yeah.
Which is
and like One does not simply walk into Mordor. That was like in like, I guess like the golden era of like early age internet memes where like Iken has cheeseburger and, you know, all these other of that era and age. And it's just so funny to like look back on like how far memes have come and and one does not simply walk into Mordor. Just, we gotta, you know, have to recognize that.
Yeah, give homage.
Gandalf walks up and says, I have no memory of this place. I think is a line, like screen capture that I've seen shared in a couple different situations or contexts. And they have to stop while Gandalf can like meditate a bit, I guess, and try and remember where they are. Frodo goes over to him and is like, hey, someone's following us. And Gandalf is like, oh yeah, it's Gollum. What? Why are you just casually mentioning that? And I think in the book, Frodo like doesn't bring this up until like several chapters after Moria. There are just like little hints that like there's some kind of sound that they can hear, like wet feet on the stone echoing in Moria, and he feels like there's someone behind him, but every time he turns around there's just like the movement of a figure, or he sees eyes in the dark. But Gandalf is straight, oh yeah, it's Gollum, he's been following us for a couple days now. He's like very casual about it, which is so weird because Gollum is like one of the most dangerous people to, or I wouldn't say that, but like we don't want him to get the ring, obviously. So I feel like Gandalf would have had a little more urgency about that situation, but he doesn't seem that worried by it. And they go into this really great conversation. I love it so much. I think when this happens in the book, it's like the second chapter that is just basically all exposition, and it's just all Gandalf and Frodo talking about the ring. So Gandalf is saying, yeah, I think Gollum has some part to play in all of this, and you know, we don't know what that will be. Time may tell. And Frodo says, I wish Bilbo had killed Gollum. Gandalf is like, no, that was, he pitied him. And that was a very like, actually like courageous thing to do, because pity, Bilbo's pity may have saved us all. Spoiler alert, it does. And also at the end of the day, Frodo's pity for Gollum also saves them, because spoiler alert, Gollum is the one who destroys the ring ultimately.
Yeah. Oh. But I think that was a really good, you're right, that was a really nice moment to also just remind people and in general, like the theme of getting rid of someone, it seems to be like the way to get rid of your problem, but if you actually walk away and just like kind of let that be, that's actually the more heroic thing. And so I think that is also just kind of like a nice little reminder to, like, that Gandalf is telling him, like, you don't just take out people just because you think where you should.
Yeah, I think he also says something along the lines of, there are a lot of people, actually, it's all mixing together. I don't know if he said this in this scene or if he says it later, but he does say at one point, he's like, there are a lot of people who deserve to live that mm-hmm. die, and mm-hmm. there are lots of people that deserve death and live to see the end of their like days, long yeah. olden days. Yeah. And that's not fair. It goes into this other part where Frodo's like, I wish this hadn't happened to me. I wish the ring had never come to me. Gandalf says, so do all who live to see such times. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given to us. There are other forces at work in this world besides the will of evil.
So and true. It's,
yeah. And it's just like so poignant for me at this point in, you know, 2020 of like, I wish this like absolutely terrible thing had never happened to me. I wish I just like wish with all my heart that coronavirus was not a thing. And it's like, yeah, we all wish that. But the unfortunate reality is that it is a reality. What matters now is just what we're doing with our days in the meantime and making the most of our lives while we can, rather than sitting around and moping about it. Yeah. I mean, that being said, still wear a mask, social distance, wash everything, all that stuff. But like, you know, it's just a rough situation to be in. And it's hard in those situations when like all you can say is like, I know and I'm sorry.
Yeah, but you got to move on. Yeah. That's so true. I think that's such a, it's so crazy that we're able to relate to that.
And then all of a sudden, Gandalf is like, oh, it's this way. Mary or Pip, someone is like, oh, you remembered. He goes, no, I don't remember, but it doesn't smell as bad this way. So I think this is the path to outside. And then he goes, when in doubt, Mary a duck, follow your nose or something like that, which is like a really funny one liner. And I feel like maybe it does come in handy later, but that would have been like really funny later on. I just can't remember off the top of my head if that does, if there is a moment, you know, later on where Mary is like, follow your nose, Pippin. And then it like leads them to safety. But like, yeah, that would have been like a cute callback for them to do.
Yeah, I can't remember.
Yeah. And then they make it out into the, I guess, courtyards or whatever of, I don't remember what it's called, the dwarf city. And that is where we are going to leave this episode. Oh, because it's a hefty movie. So much happens, man. Let's see, real quick, I want to read off some of those tweets that I had during that first time of watching Fellowship of the Ring four years ago. When Arwen comes in, I said, oh, and here's a female character who I bet anything is here only to help the male lead and serve as a love interest to others. I wasn't off with that. And then I said, he's here, the child of Lucius Malfoy and Will Turner. I took a picture of Boromir, of course, doing the one does not simply. And I said, Lord of the Rings, where memes come true. Also, each week, Catherine and I share a fact. This segment is called, is Viggo Mortensen actually a ranger? Viggo Mortensen chipped a tooth while filming a fight sequence. He wanted Peter Jackson to super glue it back on so he could finish the scene. But Jackson took him to the dentist on his lunch break, had it patched up, and returned to the set that afternoon. That's just the stamina of Viggo Mortensen, that he's like, nah, just glue it back on. We can keep going.
Oh my God. So good.
And that concludes this week's segment of, is Viggo Mortensen actually a ranger? I don't know. Time will tell. Holy cow. Okay. So Catherine, thank you for coming on to discuss this part of the movie. What would you like to share with our audience?
So I run, I'm the editor-in-chief and founder at Shuffle Online, and I write, and I have contributors who also, you know, write. We do film reviews, music, lots of nostalgia, as you can tell. I throw that in there too. Just like a shuffle of things. That's why it's called Shuffle Online. Through that, I think about 4 years ago, I went to, I think I attended South by Southwest, which just takes place in Austin. It's a big mm-hmm. festival. I was able to interview Dominic Monaghan, which, yeah, so
what
he was doing like an indie movie. I can't remember which one, because I was excited for two reasons, obviously Lord of the Rings, and also because I'm big, like I said, Lost is also very pivotal in my like film TV sort of world.
Real quick, listeners, Dominic Monaghan plays Mary.
Yes.
In Lord of the Rings.
So I was like, I don't even know what I asked. I was just like, I am interviewing Mary for, you know, and I am interviewing Charlie from Lost. It was like the best moment of my life.
Oh, that's right. He is in Lost. I totally forgot about that. Sorry, I keep interrupting you.
No. Continue. So good. Anyway, and then also through Shuffle, I went to like, I forgot what Comic Con it was. And Pip was there. He was like in his little booth or whatever. At Billy Boyd, if you're there as press, you can ask them like, oh, can I take a photo? But sometimes they're a little weird and they're like, oh, no photos at the booth. It can be hit or miss. But I was like, you know what? This is my opportunity. I was like, this is 13-year-old Catherine like going and like, I'm going to go and be awkward. And so I went up to him and I was like, hi, like, and I, you know, I do like the high voice when I get nervous. And I was just like, oh my God, like, I love you. I don't even know what I said. I was like, can I take a photo with you? And then, of you. Cause I don't know what I did. I'll have to find the photo and share it with you. But, like I got to take a photo of him or with him. I can't remember. And that was like also one of like the greatest moments of my life. So anyway,
oh my gosh.
Yeah. So, I'll try to dig them up for you, but yeah, through my website, Shuffle Online, I've been able to kind of have these moments where I've met these actors who, yeah, they're just actors or whatever, but it just like in these roles that were so pivotal in like me doing what I do now. And so it means so much more to, you know, I understand like when you geek out on that, because it's not about their role or whatever. It's just like what they meant to you and like what their little bit kind of added to the movie that you love so much. So yeah, if you want more of that, go follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Shuffle Online. And then you can find all our stories and things on shuffleonline.net.
That's so awesome. Listeners, as we're recording, this will be like, listeners will know how much I've cut down. We've been recording for, you know, over 2 hours now. I can't believe you've just been sitting on that you met Mary and Pippin.
Yeah, I was gonna insert it somewhere else, but I was like, oh, it's not the right time. And then I was like, I'll just share that later.
Oh, that's so fun. That's so awesome. That's so awesome. That's What I'm Tolkien About is a proud member of WBNE. You can learn more about the network by going to WBNE.org, where you will find all of our other shows like Late to the Party, our Dungeons and Dragons podcast.
In a world not unlike our own.
It is a balmy 80 degrees in Miami, Florida.
I'm chaotic neutral tiefling monk.
I don't recall there being tieflings in Miami.
Now, you know that hammer toss isn't an actual hammer, right?
It is in this universe.
Okay.
No, it's a big ol' hammer.
It's a big ol' sledgehammer.
Where magic and monsters run rampant.
Kind of looks like a bug monster.
Oh, Jordan has showed us a diagram of, I think, Red Eyes Black Dragon from the Yu-Gi-Oh!
Oh my god!
Well, I speak Infernal, so I'm going to ask it what the heck it is.
A real estate agent.
Lily Davis, who sells real estate by day.
A football coach.
I love you. Don't touch my flowers.
A failed actor.
I am a former Broadway star.
And a teenager.
Sunny days, a student in college, crazy, right?
Must save the world.
And you're waving your clipboard back and forth, and...
Do I feel my clipboard connect with something?
Yes.
Coming March 23rd to WBNE, Late to the Party.
The cover is by Graphite, aka Vaishon Brandon. You can support him on Instagram at graphite.vmb. You can find the podcast on Twitter and Instagram at Tolkien About Pod, and you can also join our Facebook group. You can find me on Twitter at MCWhatsUp and Instagram at MCTurnDownForWhat. And you can support the podcast by becoming a patron. You can go to patreon.com/TolkienAboutPod to explore the different tiers and financial levels, whatever is right for your situation. And you can become a sponsor of the podcast like Mayor. Mayor, thank you so much for your continued support. You've been a sponsor now for a while, so I really appreciate all of your support, especially during this exciting time when I'm now covering the movies. It's very awesome. Also, rate and review, please. When you rate and review the podcast, it helps other people find it. And I would like for there to be more listeners, I think, to say. Rinda Rue 5 said, I went looking for a chapter by chapter Lord of the Rings podcast and was delighted to found That's What I'm Talking About. The pun alone drew me in. I love that Mary Clay is also reading the books for the first time while discussing them in a more casual and digestible way. I listened to this while I work. Oh my god, I can't believe you do that. I'm sorry for you that you have to listen to my voice while you work. Her outlandish predictions make me crack up, and I love how much she dislikes Sam, even though I don't. Oh yeah, Catherine context. When I was reading the books, I did not like Sam. He was just very annoying. He's a lot less annoying in the movies. Love that it is a Lord of the Rings podcast hosted by a woman and that MC isn't afraid to call out the misinterpretation of women in this series while still keeping it fun. Keep Tolkien it up, girl. Thanks. Yeah, I'll talk about, calling out the women in this series. We did a lot of that on this episode. What up? It's Mary Clay from the future here one last time this episode to say that next week we will be picking up right where we left off this week. It'll be about 1 hour and 52 minutes in the theatrical edition, and we will go right to the end of Fellowship of the Ring. So that'll be a fun time. And back to the past. Whew. Okay, so that brings us to the end of this episode. Catherine, thank you for joining me once again. Do you have any parting words for the audience?
If you're a first-time viewer, I hope you enjoy as much as I did. I wish I could get back my first watch of Lord of the Rings, because it just meant so much to me.
And that's what I'm talking about.